Hello everybody, my name is Walter and this is the third episode of Mods and Circuits series. In this episode I will talk about memory circuits and how you can build them in Minecraft. I won't go into the details of the theory behind them since I already covered this in my Redstone Logic series, links for that you can find in the description. But anyway, this episode will be about how you can actually create memory circuits in Minecraft using the various different Redstone components. I will only be able to cover the most important ones since, as always, there are a near infinite amount of different variations you can build, but I want to give you at least a broad understanding of what is possible and what are the important ways or the usual ways to create memory circuits in Minecraft. And that should be enough of a prologue, so let's get straight to the memory circuits. And with that, I'll start with the Ars Knowledges. Now, the simplest Ars Knowledge and pretty much the oldest in the game is the double torch loop. So if you have a loop made out of two torches, and you have essentially a very simple Ars knowledge. Here you have the OR and the NOT part, and then this is done twice, and such you have an Ars knowledge. This has obviously two stable states and is triggered by the high level. Since it's such a simple circuit, you have a multitude and pretty much infinite amount of different configurations, so you can also have a more vertical setup, or you can have one inverter here, the other over there, and then loop them with some lines. It doesn't really matter. You can also use other types of inverters for that. Another Ars knowledge you can see here. This is basically an OR gate with an inhibition gate in a loop. So you can build one such thing by, for example, looping back a repeater into itself and then removing the block either in front of the repeater or behind the repeater. You could also build this with a full block being here and then being moved via a piston, for example. Also, there are many, many different setups for this thing here. So pretty much all I will show you today has various different configurations. You can actually build them, and I will show you just one main example. Anyway, the next one is a bit different because it's an edge-triggered flip-flop. Now, those two were level-triggered. This here is edge-triggered since it works with droppers, and droppers only check at the moment they are triggered or they are powered. If they are in a butted state, they will trigger the next moment they get a block update, obviously. Now, how does this thing work? Well, we have two droppers facing each other and they contain a single item. And if I were to power the dropper with the item obviously gets pushed into the other one. Now, this means that the outputs are a bit inverted, or the output logic is somewhat inverted, meaning the input you trigger actually turns off in the corresponding output. This is one thing to keep in mind when you're working with this. Now, another thing to keep in mind is that you must avoid powering both droppers at the same time with the same input. So this is the reason why I'm powering those indirectly. If I were to power them directly, since the dropper is a full block, it would also automatically power the other block. Indirectly means in this case you can use, for example, a directly powered full block, or you could also power it, for example, with a torch from the side. Or also from here, since it would also butt power and at the same time debut the dropper. But the important part for an Ars knowledge is that it is indirectly powered, not directly. You will see what happens when it's directly powered in a few moments. So, quick insert here, I forgot one thing to mention about dropper-based flip-flop designs, and that is that the transition between the two inputs, if you need to use both, is completely smooth. Pretty much all of the other versions here have a slight delay between one input changing or one output changing and the other output or the inverted output also changing. For dropper-based ones, you have just the delay of the comparators, which is in both cases obviously one redstone tick. So the transition here is completely smooth, as you can see there. So as you can see, One turns off and at the same moment the other turns on, so you have no overlap and no gap in between, which can be quite useful if you have some issues with the fine tuning of your circuits. Anyway, let's get to the more analog variations or redstone analogs. So now I want to show you a few things that work with comparators. The first you can see here is essentially once more the same as the torch loop, but this time using comparators in a subtract mode. And the theory behind it is pretty much the same, but now you have one big advantage, and that is that you have isolated inputs. So you can power it from those sides, and as you can see, you still have your information in here, but you don't get any kind of feedback out of those control lines. That can be quite an advantage and basically means that you have a classic Ars knowledge in this case. Also rather nice, due to the way that this here works, you can also store different signal strengths. And what you have is that the signal strength here and the signal strength here always add up to 15 in total. So in this case, 0 and 15, but it could also be 7 and 8. So this can also be used to store analog redstone signals. Now, the next one appears to be analog, but it is mostly usable in a binary way. And here we are not using them as a loop with two NOR gates, but instead we're using them as a loop with two NAND gates. Now, this is a very interesting circuit, as you can see when this one here is triggered, and I power this one here, I can't power this one here. Only when I depower this one here, the power can travel to this point. And in my redstone logic series, I'm called this a counterlocking inputs circuit, but the official name is actually a Ars NAND latch, since this is a loop with two NAND gates instead of two NOR gates. Nevertheless, a very interesting and occasionally very useful and very compact way to go about this. Now another analog Ars knowledge you can see here. In this case, you are not storing one signal strength of one input here and the other there, and both add up to 15. Now we are storing one signal strength in a complete loop, and we can subtract from that signal strength with another input. If you're using it with a signal strength of 15 via buttons, for example, then you have an Ars knowledge again, which you can turn on or off. Or in this case, it's once more again a loop of an OR gate and an inhibition gate. But you can also use this in an analog way to basically make a subtraction circuit or similar. Next up, we have the JK flip-flops. Now, they are closely related to the Ars knowledges, but have one advantage, and that is that they only change their output states or their internal state when the inputs are in opposite states, meaning the problem Ars knowledges have with both inputs being turned on at the same time, they don't have. Now, one of the simplest ones is actually using two normal pistons facing each other with two blocks in between, and in between them you have either a redstone block or a block over some torches. Now, as you can see, as long as the one piston here is extended, I can't actually trigger this one here. Only if I attack this one here, I can extend this one here. So pretty standard JK behavior. Now, what are the observers here for? Now, pretty simple. Those pistons here will get budded, and those here are there to create block updates to debud them when they can actually extend at some point. With this automatic debudding, you have a level triggered JK flip-flop. If you were to remove that one, you have an edge triggered one. So this here is basically two different types of JK flip-flop in one with just one minor modification. Obviously, there are ways to build not just a horizontal, but also a vertical situation. But if you're doing that, you will have to make sure that you don't accidentally put one of those pistons here, to be more precise, the one at the bottom, into a state where it will never be able to retract again. In that case, composters or filled cauldrons are the way to go. Now, another JK flip-flop, which is also based on pistons, you can see here. This time not normal pistons, but sticky pistons. Using a corner situation like this here, you can actually create a level-triggered JK flip-flop without any reason or need for a debudding, because the debudding automatically happens through the retracting of the other piston, as you can see here. Curiously, I actually have never seen this one used in any way, but maybe I just haven't looked around far enough. And the last JK flip I have for you today is a derivative of this dropper-based RS knowledge. Now, before I mentioned that you have to depower or to power them indirectly. Now, if you power them directly, what happens is that you are first triggering the directly connected and then the other dropper. Interesting enough, this can still be used similarly to an RS knowledge with now just having a non-inverted output logic corresponding to the inverted output logic of the RS knowledge. The major difference here is that if one side stays powered, the other can change its state as often as you want, nothing will happen. And only once both sides are depowered and then the other one powers, the state can once more change. So this is a edge-triggered JK flip-flop based on droppers. One interesting fact about this, you can use pretty much any way to power those droppers directly, except for the torch. Well, you can use the torch, but then the logic inverts again. For some reason, the torch first updates the dropper that is indirectly powered and then updates the dropper that is powered. So you could actually have a JK flip-flop that is set up like this here. One input would be via this torch here and the other would be via, for example, this lever here. And you wouldn't have to actually run any input into this dropper at the bottom, top, and yet have a fully functional and fully controllable JK flip-flop. Also, what you can see here is you can have a horizontal or a vertical setup. And obviously, you can also just place one comparator if you only need one of those two outputs. Following that, let's talk about D flip-flops. Now, you could create D flip-flops using logic networks, even in Minecraft, but I wouldn't recommend it, because simply put, those are really big and really expensive and not worth your time. Especially since there are much better alternatives in the game, as you will see in a few seconds. So you won't get any examples for that. You can find some of them in the Wikipedia entries. A link for that you can also find in the description. But anyway, let's start with the two repeater-based ones. Now, a very simple D flip-flop is based on the fact that you can lock a repeater in its current state by simply running a repeater or a comparator into the side of the repeater. And that means that you already have a D flip-flop which triggers on a low level. So basically a D flip-flop with an inverted clock or trigger signal. If you just take a single one of those, you have a level-triggered one. If you put two D flip-flops behind each other and invert one of the side inputs, like you can see here, you have a edge-triggered version. Depending on where you put your inversion, you have a rising or a falling edge. In this case, it's the rising edge. Because, as you can see, if I power this one here, and I have a rising edge, I get this power to the output. pretty straightforward. Just note that I put this repeater here on 2 ticks, so that the delay on this side and the delay on this side is the same. So we have this very smooth transition and no issues with some signals jumping the line. Shouldn't happen, but this is just to be extra sure that the timing is correct. And the last D flip-flop I want to show you is actually an analog D flip-flop. Once more, it's a level trigger design. This here triggers on a low level, but you can obviously also turn it around and make it a high level one. Anyway, how does this thing work? Basically, what we have here is our analog Ars knowledge from before. And what we're doing is, essentially, when the signal is traveling through this, and we are on a low level, then we are just connecting the input with the output. And the rest of the circuit here doesn't do anything. Now, if we switch that around, what happens is we unlock this feedback here. So now we have a feedback loop going on and it remembers the current state. And at the same time, we are turning off our input. So in this case, we are basically putting an inhibition gate into the input. And that means that the input is disconnected and the output stays at the same level as before. And with that, we come to the fourth flip-flop I want to talk about today, which is the T flip-flop. Now, as with the D flip-flop, you could create them using logic networks, but once more, it's not really worth your time, since there are much better options in the game. And with that, let's start with the one I personally use pretty much the most often, which is the T flip-flop based on a one-ticked piston. Now, sticky pistons, when they are one-ticked, have a very interesting behavior that when they have a block directly in front of them, they spit out that block, and if the block is apart from them, they will retract the block. So each one-tick pulse going in here toggles the output of this T flip-flop here. An older version uses a piston-based monostable circuit to create a one-tick pulse. There are also other ways to create logic networks that create such short pulses. A bit more modern and a bit more versatile, usually, is using an observer, which is, for example, moved by another piston. Obviously, there are a whole lot of different configurations for that. Some of them are horizontal, some are vertical. If you're building them vertical, once more, make sure that when the block is, or the piston is at the bottom, use a compostor or a cauldron with a comparator to take an output then. But there are pretty much endless possibilities there. Next up, we have this setup here, which is made out of 2 sticky pistons facing each other with a block in between. And then at the top, we have what essentially boils down to a monostable circuit, which has a negative or inverted output. So basically what happens here is the piston is both powered by the redstone wire and this block and also powered by the torch. Now, while the input is powered, let's quickly get a lever here. Now, while the input is powered, nothing changes. Now, if I depower the input, we have a one tick window where the torch is not yet turned on, which means that those pistons here can retract. Since the torches turn on once more, they will then try to extend at once. This one here can extend or can retract. This one here can't extend. When this one here retracts, it pulls back that block, updates this piston, which then at once extends, and we're in the opposite configuration. And if we give it a next pulse, the whole thing happens once more. So this one here is a T flip-flop that triggers on a falling edge. Now you can build different variations of that. For example, not with the inputs at the very top, but at the very bottom. Here, since I'm adding another inversion to the two inputs. I have not a falling but a rising edge as a trigger. But the principle behind this is pretty much the same as before. This, by the way, is also used in some block swapper designs. Next up, we have a setup that uses the fact that full blocks can redirect redstone wire. So now what happens in this situation here? We have this redstone wire running into the empty air here. So on this side, nothing happens. On this side, we have a repeater running into this block, which obviously powers this sticky piston here. Now if we power this line here, what happens is what we have expected. Now the situation has changed. We have a redstone line running into this block. And since we have no delay here, but one tick delay here, the piston here will trigger first and stop this one here from extending. So as you can see, we have a T flip-flop triggered on a rising edge. The output is pretty straightforward, just whether we have a block in this place here or not. And that's it. Interesting enough, since you are just shuffling blocks back and forth, and both pistons are usually retracted, you can also use this as an Ars knowledge without any issue. So this is basically an RS and T flip-flop. Another way to create a T flip-flop is using a loop with a single inversion in there. So this one here is actually a clock, which would cycle and change its state over and over. And we are unlocking the repeater in this case here only for half a cycle. So as you can see, the circuit over here just creates a very short pulse or a very short negative pulse. And what you can see is we have one half cycle going through, and this is thus a rising edge triggered T flip-flop. Very interesting design right there. Another way to create a T flip-flop is using a edge triggered D flip-flop and just looping it back with one inversion. So this here, as you have seen before, is just a rising edge triggered D flip-flop. And all I added is basically one inversion and a loopback here. Also pretty straightforward and a very basic design. The next T flip-flop design is known as Grisdale's T flip-flop, and it is based once more on the update order of directly powered droppers. Now what we basically have here is a big, or just a small loop. We have a dropper at the bottom, which feeds into a top dropper, which feeds into a chest, which once more feeds into a hopper, which then feeds back into the bottom dropper. So one loop. If we were to directly power the top dropper, or we torch the bottom dropper, what happens is first this one here is executed, then this one here. Or this one is first triggered, then this one here. If the item is in the bottom one, it's first this one here triggers empty, and then this one here pushes up. Now the item's in here. If we trigger this once more, what happens is first this one here is triggered, pushes it into the chest, and then into the hopper. Then this one here triggers. But while this one here triggers, the hopper has still the item in there, and only after that the hopper has the time to push it over. As you can see, now the item is at the bottom again. The disadvantage of this is that you have asymmetric behavior. You have a smooth transition from the bottom to the top, but you have a 4-tick delay in the opposite direction, which can be a bit annoying. Interesting enough, you can also build this in a purely horizontal way with using two hoppers instead of a hopper in the chest. And you can also tile them and stack them a bit if you are careful about it. And last T flip of today is this one here. I actually showed you this already in my Redstone component series when I talked about rails. since this one here is a minecart-based T-flip-flop. Now, how does this thing work? Well, once more, we have essentially a sticky piston with a monostable circuit, which retracts it for just a moment at the falling edge. And what happens is this minecart here is on a diagonal sensor rail. So it powers the side it is on, and it also powers, by the way, the powered rail in between. Now, if we remove the block which is blocking it from moving, it starts to move and then can move onto the other side. So classical T flip flop design. Now, the delays involved here are not that small. As you can see, the whole thing here needs some time, but it's a rather interesting circuit, although I personally have never used this in any of my contraptions. And with that, we come to the last part of this episode, which are shift registers and ring memories, or to be more precise, one example of each. Let's start with the shift registers. Now, what you can see here is oftenly referred to as a repeater oscilloscope. Now, what basically happens here is that you have a line of repeaters, all of them are on one tick. You have another line of repeaters, which are all placed to lock the first line of repeaters, and they are all powered at the same time. Now, what you can do with a setup like this here is that you can look at the signal traveling through this, and you can see whether the signal is, for example, one tick long, or one tick pulse, or maybe a two tick pulse, or a three tick pulse, or whatever. You can also freeze it by simply powering this line of repeaters, and that means that you can at all times, if you're fast enough with that, freeze the signal and see what the signal was at that very moment, one tick before, two tick before, three tick before, and so on. So you can analyze the way the signal changed over time. That's the reason it's called an oscilloscope. Now, this can also be used as a shift register. Now, how does this work? Pretty straightforward. All we need to do is to unlock those repeaters here for one tick. And the easiest way to do this is actually the setup you can see here. So, similar to before, we have basically a monostable circuit which produces a negative or inverted output pulse of one tick length. Or in the other way around, a one tick pause. And that's pretty much the easiest way you can create a shift register in Minecraft. Now, to create a ring memory, you can, for example, use a shift register and then just loop back the output into the input. But in Minecraft, there is a much more interesting way, and that are piston feed tapes. Now, a piston feed tape are at least four pistons in a kind of loop setup here, with a loop of blocks in between. Obviously, you need some gaps in there, so the pistons can actually move the blocks around. Although there are piston feed tape setups that have no gaps, but they are much more complicated than they need to be for a ring memory setup. Anyway, how does this example here work? I have at the bottom a piston here, which I trigger every time I trigger the lever, which moves the blocks up. That triggers this observer and then this piston here, which moves the freshly moved block and those two over. And then here happens the same one and here until we have a similar configuration of blocks in the center with just all blocks moved once clockwise, as you can see here. Pretty straightforward design. Now, you can use this to encode information in a ring memory. You can do this in a binary or in an analog or digital value way. The binary is pretty simple. You can either have a full block or a transparent block. By using, for example, a torch below or powering it from the back with a repeater or similar, you either can get some power out of that block or not. And that's essentially your input. So, for example, a full block would be a 2 or a 1 as an output, and a transparent block would be a false or a 0 as an output. Now, if you're using a comparator in combination with compositors or cauldrons, you can even encode different signal strengths, because you can fill them up to different levels. The cauldron only has the levels 0, which would be empty, 1, 2, and 3. The compositor has the levels 0, which is once more empty, and then 1, 2, up to 6. The 7 is unstable, and then an 8. Which means that you have a lot of more possibilities with the compositor. You can also combine both, like in this example here. Just keep in mind that the compositor and the cauldron are both transparent blocks, so their use is somewhat limited. Now, one more thing to mention here is that the number of blocks inside of this loop here can be adjusted if you adjust the circuitry around it. Simply put, each piston feed tape has at least 4 corners. If you want to add more corners, you have to add 2 at a time, so it stays a closed loop. So, first minimum, then you would have 6, 8, and so on. Also, the number of blocks and gaps for each corner is limited. You need at least one gap and one corner. You need one corner because somewhere you need to be able to start moving. You also need one gap because you need to be able to start moving into that gap. There are some setups that don't have gaps, but they have a very complex piston setup, which is not really usable or not really that good for situations where you just want to memorize a certain sequence in a ring memory. Now, in between those two limitations, one gap, one corner block, you are pretty much free. So for a setup with 4 pistons, you have actually a 1 block, 2 block, and 3 block setup possibilities. So 3 different setups. Now you have to make sure that the entire thing still works without moving blocks out of the loop. If you want an even number of blocks inside of that loop here, the best setup would be to have a corner here and a corner block here. Power this piston at the same time. Move the blocks into this gap here. And then power, after a short delay, this piston here. That can be also be done automatically with the observer setup from here. That way, you have an even number of blocks and you also halve the time the whole sequence takes. Because now you have just 2 steps to move and you're doing this twice at the same time, basically, instead of having 4 sequential moves, one after the other, like in this example here. But this whole thing with working with piston feed tapes is somewhat of an art form. If you want to go that far into the details, so I think this should actually be enough for this episode here. And with that, we have finally reached the end of this episode about memory circuits. I hope you enjoyed this little episode, and well, see ya!